This is HiroJa Chef, and I'm here to guide you through the daily activities, events, and the ins and outs of what occurs on the street. So sit back, relax, enjoy your cup of coffee, purchase one with some Hong Kong bucks, and enjoy a word from the Metaverse. Hello, and welcome to the Metaverse. I'm your host, HiroJa Shibe, speaking to you from a small cafe adjacent to the famous Black Sun Bar, giving you the latest on what is happening on the street and what is affecting our world here in the meta as well as in real life. This episode, we're going to talk about basic income. It's one of the part of the three-episode topical discussions we're doing, the first one being the Facebook manifesto, this one, the second one being basic income, and the third one about Peter Thiel and Big Brother coming in to get you. But before we get into our topic, the news. This article comes from The Interceptor, written by Michael Yee, and it's called How to Run a Rogue Government Twitter Account with an Anonymous Email Address and a Burner Phone. For those who are maybe not so in-depth with social media, Twitter is probably one of the better broadcasters of information there is out there. I know a lot of people utilize Facebook as more for sharing and discussing maybe information, while Twitter is more for announcements. I would consider it more of like a town crier from old who would come and yell, you know, the news or the business of the day. Well, Twitter is very much in that vein. A lot of governmental discussions or announcements come through Twitter. We currently have within the states a president that frequently uses both the official POTUS Twitter handle, but primarily his own personal Twitter handle, to just comment on anything and everything. It makes you wonder how he has the time to do such things with the running of the government. But what has happened because of this particular administration, and a lot of it has to do with like old business with the Bush administration, Obama, Clinton, all these things that have been percolating within the society about the actions of government, the inactions of government, the things that are prioritized and not prioritized, basically the lies. It's getting more and more difficult for lies to be told, if you will. There's an expression, do your Googles. Shout out to Gaming and Minson, Sterling and Company, that has popularized that term for me anyways, where you can do your research within seconds about any particular statement. You know, something as simple as, like, is the sky blue? Someone can just boop, 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 and then find out all the different kind of information from very scientific papers about the atmosphere, to pictures, to video, to people blogging or discussing the nature of the color of the sky. As a result of certain actions, particularly because of one particular party, the Republican Party, is against, climate change, certain forms of regulation, things of that nature. There has been various individuals and entities within the government that have been discussing or spilling the tea, if you will, certain aspects of the government that hasn't quite occurred before. There have been, you know, whistleblowers that would like disclose, you know, documents and things of that nature. But these are people that are doing day-to-day counterpoints to the narrative that's been created by the ruling party here in the states and the current president. And one of those things is the national parks, as well as various scientific groups within the U.S. government speaking about certain actions and things that are taking place. So one of the first things that Donald Trump did when he took office was temporarily gag several federal agencies, forbidding them from tweeting. In response, several described government workers created a wave of rogue Twitter accounts to share the real facts, not to confuse with alternative facts otherwise known as lies, about climate change and science. As a rule, the people running the accounts choose to remain anonymous, fearing retaliation. But depending on how they created and use their accounts, they are not necessarily anonymous to Twitter itself or anyone Twitter shares data with. Anonymous speech is firmly protected by the First Amendment, and the Supreme Court in the history of the U.S. dates to the Federalist Papers, written to 1787 and 1788 on the pseudonym Publius by three of the Founding Fathers. But the technical ability for people to remain anonymous on today's internet, where every scrap of data is meticulously tracked, is an entirely different issue. The FBI, a domestic intelligence agency that claims the power to spy on anyone based on suspicion, that don't come close to probable cause has a long, dark history of violating the rights of Americans. In particular, there was a program that tracked the civil rights movement, particularly the Black Panthers, where more and more increasingly several documents, something that's been known within the Black community, and those that are familiar with the history of the civil rights movements are very well aware of the various tactics and techniques and informants and things of the nature the FBI had done in the past, particularly in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. But programs are still continuing on to this day that even targeted other different groups, from the gay rights movement to environmental agencies, or not agencies, but environmental groups, and some of them on behalf of interested private parties, such as various businesses, if you will. But I digress. And now it reports directly to President Trump, who is a pretty revenge-based authoritarian with utter respect for the courts and the rule of law. In this environment, how easy is it to create and maintain a Twitter account while preserving anonymity, even from Twitter and any law enforcement agency that may request its records? I try to find out and document all my steps. There are different ways to accomplish this. If you plan on following these steps, you should make sure you understand the purpose of them, in case you need to improvise. I also can't guarantee that these techniques will protect your anonymity. There are countless ways that things can go wrong. Many of them are social rather than technical, but I hope you will at least have a fighting chance to keep your real identity private. For the exercise, I decided to pick a highly controversial political topic. Facts. I believe that we know about realities based on evidence that can be objectively observed. Thus, I created the completely anonymous, until published in this article, of course, the Twitter account, Facts Not Alt. Here's how I did it. The threat model. Before we begin, it helps to define a threat model. That is, what we need to protect, who we need to protect it from, and what their capabilities are, and what countermeasures prevent or mitigate these threats. Basically, it's impossible to be completely secure all the time, so we need to prioritize or limited resources in protecting what matters the most first. The most important piece of information you need to protect in this case is your real identity. Law enforcement or the FBI might launch an investigation aimed at learning your identity. It may be to retaliate against you, getting you fired, charging you with crimes, or worse. Your Twitter account might also anger armies of trolls who could threaten you, abuse you with hate speech, and try to uncover your identity. If the FBI opens an investigation aimed at de-anonymizing you, one of the first things they'll do is simply ask Twitter and every other service that you know they know you use for information about your account. So critical, important countermeasure is to ensure that none of the information tied to your account, phone numbers, emails, addresses, or IP addresses you've used while logging into your account, lead back to you. This is true for all accounts you create. For instance, if you supply a phone number while creating your Twitter account, the phone service provider associated with that number shouldn't have the information that can lead back to you either. Another concern, the FBI also might go undercover online and try to befriend you to trick you to revealing details about yourself or trick you into clicking a link to hack you. This might make you use the information in the community of people who follow you on Twitter as well. Organized trolls might use the same tactic. Hiding your IP address with Tor. An IP address is a set of numbers that identifies a computer or network of computers or on the internet. Unless you take extra steps, every website you visit can see your IP address. If you're using Twitter while connected to your home or office Wi-Fi network or your phone's data plan, Twitter can tell. If they hand these IP addresses to the FBI, you will quickly lose your anonymity. This is where Tor comes in. Tor is a decentralized network. We know what Tor is. This primary benefit of Tor has over virtual private networks or VPN services, which should try to help users hide their IP address. The FBI can go to a VPN service and learn your real IP address, assuming the VPN keeps a record of its IP addresses and cooperates with these requests. This isn't true with Tor. There's actually a very good list of breakdowns of VPN services, virtual privacy networks, and we'll talk about that term eventually when we talk about in a week where I'm going to discuss things like Tor, dark mail, if you will, and VPN services, different services people can use to prevent tracking, as well as different browser apps that Firefox and others have developed to kind of keep you anonymous, not just from, you know, government services, or if you will, but like from ad tracking, if you will. To get started with Tor, you can download the Tor browser. It's a web browser like Chrome or Firefox. You can also protect yourself from Tor browser security bugs by using an operating system designed to protect your anonymity, such as Tails or Qubits with Unix. I've written about that later here. There's more work for you, but it might be worth it. Presumably, I'm using Qubits with Unix. Getting an anonymous email address. Before you can create nearly any account online, you need an email address. While popular email services like Gmail or Yahoo Mail, you shouldn't be using Yahoo let it anyone take make an account for free. They don't make it easy to do it anonymously. Most of them require that you verify your identity with a phone number. You can, in fact, do that anonymously. More on that below, but I prefer using an email provider that is happy to give addresses to anonymous users. One of those private providers is Signet, a darknet-only service that forces all its users to log in using Tor to read or send emails. The people who run it are anonymous, and it contains ads for sometimes very sketchy, sorry, darknet websites. However, you do end up with a working anonymous email address. There was also an update in the article. The Signet service appears to be down right now. While it's down, you can try Rise Up or set up a burner phone and then try Proton Mail, Gmail, or some other services instead. If you prefer not to use the Signet, another good choice is Rise Up, a technology collective that provides email lists, VPN, and other similar services to activists around the world. Accounts are free, and they don't ask for your identity information, but you do need an invite code from a friend who's already using Rise Up in order to create an account. Your other option is Proton Mail. I personally have Proton Mail myself. A privacy-friendly email provider based in Switzerland asks for minimal identification information and works well over Tor. However, to prevent abuse, they require Tor users to provide a phone number that they promise not to store to receive an SMS during account creation. So if you like to use Proton Mail instead or any other email service to require a phone number when creating an account or Tor, follow the steps below to create an anonymous phone number first. And then he describes how he uses Signet to create an email account. Getting an anonymous phone number. While attempting to create a Twitter account, I quickly hit a snag. Even if I provide an anonymous email address, Twitter won't let me create a new account without first verifying my phone number. You might get lucky and get the option to skip entering your phone number. It doesn't hurt to try, but if you're coming from a Tor node, that isn't likely. The problem, because I obviously can't use my real phone number if I want to remain anonymous, so to proceed, I need to figure out how to get a phone number that isn't tied to my actual identity. This is a common problem when trying to stay anonymous online, so you can follow these instructions anytime you need a phone number when opening an account. There are other ways to do it, but I chose a conceptually simple option. Buy a burner phone anonymously, use it to verify my Twitter account, and then get rid of it. I wandered around downtown San Francisco looking in convenience stores and pharmacies to find what I was looking for in a 7-Eleven. Using cash, I bought the cheapest track phone handset I could find, an LG 328BG feature phone, as in, and not a smartphone, as well as 60 minutes worth of voice services for a total of $62.38 after tax. You might be able to find a cheaper cell phone handset if you look long enough. If you're going to get a burner phone and want to maintain your identity, here are some things to keep in mind. Buy your burner phone handset and prepaid service using cash. Don't use a credit card. When you buy services, the clerk activates your service card at the cash register. This tells the phone company, track phone in my case, exactly which store you bought it from and when. Keep this in mind and consider picking a store far away from where you live, like where you're traveling in another city. Security cameras will probably record your face at the store. Most stores delete old footage on a regular basis, overriding it with new footage. If you possible, wait a week or two before start tweeting, so the footage is already deleted by the time anyone tries to figure out your real identity. You can find phones and services like that at some convenience stores and pharmacies. If you need to do internet research to find a store near you that sells burner phones, use Tor browser. Also look for swap meets. I would even go as far as, if you can, seeking convenience stores that don't necessarily have the best security, if you will, where it's obvious that the cameras that they have are either non-existent or not there. Smoke shops are notoriously known for that, if you will. You could find these type of stores pretty much anywhere, any small kind of kiosk business, and buy a track phone or similar phones to that. You can get a small track phone for less than $20 plus another $20 for activation. So you can spend less than $40. I even say you can go as low as $25 to purchase a phone, if you will. As soon as you power your burner phone, it will connect to a cell phone tower and the phone company will know your location. So don't activate your phone or keep it powered on at all at your home or office. Instead, go to a public place like a coffee shop before activating your new phone. Keep it powered off while you're not using it. Don't use the burner phone's number for anything at all that isn't related to the specific project. This is called compartmentalization. If someone discovers the entire history of that phone number, they shouldn't be able to learn anything new. Each cell phone handset has a unique identifier. So if you need a second phone number at some point in the future and you don't want it to be connected to your first phone, you'll have to buy a second handset. After buying the phone service, you need to activate the phone. This process will be different with different phone companies. Track phone requires you to activate your handset either by calling their phone number from a different phone, obviously not a good option for someone trying to remain anonymous, or by activating online at the website. I activated my burner phone online using the Tor browser, which is very smart. If you have to use an activation, if you will, I recommend if you can, I know at least in my area there's at least six to 10 payphones that are functioning and are still working within my area. If you live in an area where there's still existing payphones, I would try that. I would try to see if you can ask to utilize a phone, maybe within this very same convenience store that you purchased your phone. You can ask the clerk, can I activate the phone here? You know, it never hurts to ask. I know very early on when minutes and buying phones within convenience stores were very popular in the early aughts, that was a common practice. So it doesn't hurt to ask, and it will help minimize any kind of connection to any particular individual place, if you will. Creating a Twitter account anonymously first. Finally, armed with an email address and a phone number that aren't in any way connected to my real identity, I created a Twitter account. Before making an account, grab your laptop and burner phone and go to a public location that isn't your phone or office, such as a coffee shop. When you get there, power on your burner phone. Keep in mind that this location is now tied to your burner phone, so you might wish to do this step when you're traveling in another city. Using Tor browser, I navigated to twitter.com signup and signed up for a new account. The new account form asks for my full name, facts are true, my email address, factsaretrue@signet.org, and a password. After clicking sign up, I was immediately prompted to enter my phone number. I typed my anonymous phone number and click call me. A Twitter robot called my burner and read out a six-digit number, which I typed into the next page under the Tor browser, and it worked great. With the phone number verification step completed, I power off my burner phone. Once you're sure you don't need your burner phone anymore, it's a good idea to get rid of it. Towards the end of the sign-up process, Twitter prompted me to come up with a new username. After many tries, I found one I liked, facts not alt. After clicking through the welcome screen, I finally logged into my new anonymous account. I went and confirmed that I controlled my factsaretrue@signet.org email address. And there you have it. I set up a new account and began tweeting about things that are true. The only problem with this at the moment is the fact that if you want to prevent any type of hacks, if you will, two-factor authentication is not something you could do with a burner phone, because you would have to keep it on you, if you will, which is the only downside I would see with this. But if that's not a concern, if this is an account that you can easily dump at will and just state that, you know, you no longer control it, then that might not be a concern. Maintaining the Twitter account over time. Is the following long, you now have created a completely anonymous Twitter account as well. Congratulations, but your work only just started. Now comes the hard part. Maintaining this account for months or years without making any mistakes that compromise your identity. I won't be following these tips with myself with the facts that now come. I've already outed myself as the owner, but for anyone trying to anonymously maintain a popular Twitter account, there are some things to keep in mind, but be careful how you interact with people. You should operate on a strict need-to-know basis. Don't tell anyone who doesn't need to know that you are involved with running this account. Don't brag. This is by far the easiest way to mess up and for your real identity to come out. Gossip. Be careful about what privileged information you tweet. If you're part of a small group of people who have access to some information and you tweet about it, you might become a suspect when before you weren't. If the account becomes popular, might begin having conversations with lots of strangers on the internet. Be careful what you say, even if you're saying it in a private message. Some of the strangers might be gaining your trust in hopes that you'll slip and tell them scraps of information about your identity. You can always turn off DMs. Be careful about clicking links that people send you. They could be trying to learn your IP address or even try to hack Tor browsers. Avoid clicking them at all. And if you really want to click one, first make sure you're running the very latest of Tor browsers and set your security slider to high. Be conscious of your word choice. People might analyze your writing style to de-anonymize you, so you should try to write in a voice that's distinct from your own. If you can, for example, it shouldn't be wise for Donald Trump to tweet, "The failing at the Intercept keeps writing fake news sad," for this is his anonymous account, because people might suspect that he's the person behind the account. This is what some Twitter handles, these government ones, where they have multiple people throughout the world tweeting, so they have access to the account, so it allows for a stronger anonymity, but also for the voice tracking not to occur. You can always try to, for example, if you have Word or any type of office document, you can always go very high with, or you even using Grammarly, and try to click what you're about to tweet, put it in the program, and then have it check your spelling and grammar and see if you can change the, you know, the synonyms and things like that nature, and allow you to either change your word verbiage, if you will, to something completely different. So that way you're not using the common vernacular or the common style that you typically used when tweeting or speaking or writing in general.
Never log in from your work computer. Many computers spy on their employees' computers. Use a personal computer instead. Also avoid your work network. Many companies log exactly which computers connect to the network and what they do online. Tor hides what you're doing, but the company can still tell what you're using Tor on their network. Always use Tor browser when using your account. Don't log in on your phone. Don't log with any other browser. Don't even look at your anonymous Twitter account while logging into your personal account. When you're logging into your anonymous account, don't follow your personal account or the accounts of any of your friends. Don't retweet or like any of those tweets either. Basically, don't make any obvious who your social group is. So don't follow people. Just tweet. You can have zero followers. If you have to, like, follow one, do what Deadpool does and follow Kitty, a little Miss Kitty account, if you will, the very popular from the 90s Japanese figure. You know, something very innocuous, and just leave it as your one follower, as someone you follow. So you're not being tagged, if you will. And minimize your retweets. Be very careful what it is you do retweet, because you don't want your followers, just like this writer is writing about, being connected or linked through any malicious links as well. You might just be someone who just tweets and doesn't retweet at all, or quote tweets. Many successful Twitter accounts have a team of people who run them instead of a single individual. If you're a part of such a team or are thinking of sharing your account to your existing account with someone new, only invite people who you know and trust. Come up with a set of operational security rules, like the rules listed above, and make sure that everyone involved understands them and is on the same page. Come up with a secure communication channel as a team and only discuss Twitter accounts using this channel or in person. There are many different technologies you can use, all with different trade-offs, but one option is to use the encrypted message app Signal. Create a Signal group with an anonymous name and set your messages to automatically disappear after a short time, like 5 minutes. Instead of just tweeting when you come up with ideas, edit each other's tweets. This will improve the quality of the tweets and it could help delete style analysis, since you will end up with a shared voice. And finally, keep in mind that after all this, Twitter can always kick you off for their own reasons. And if your account gets hacked and the email address associated with it is changed, you'll have no way to recover it. Good luck. He's talking about the two-factor authentication deal there. So that is one way to create an anonymous Twitter account in this day and age, if you will. And then I have linked an article of a video about, because electric cars are becoming more and more prominent, I believe either Sweden or Finland by like 2035 will not permit any electric cars into their country. Their goal is to have everyone have an electric car and get rid of the gas combustion vehicle, if you will. And so it talks about a very early incarnation of an electric car called the C5, which was created in Europe, I believe England specifically. And it talks about the possibility of it coming back, if you will, and how it was very much ahead of its time. Kim.com can be extradited, New Zealand High Court rules. We're going to talk about Kim.com eventually. He's a very prominent figure in the internet world, about his court case, Mega Upload, which was an extremely popular file sharing site, and his ongoing battle with the U.S. court to not be in, or the U.S. government, I should say, to not be extradited over copyright infringement and some other weird charges that have been applied to him. So Kim.com, the founder of the content sharing site Mega Upload, can legally be extradited to the U.S. New Zealand's High Court has ruled. .com is wanted by the U.S. on a number of charges, including fraud and copyright infringement. Three other Megaload accused can be extradited, the court said, upholding an earlier ruling in the district court. The four said they will appeal against the decision. Mega Upload was shut down in 2012, allowing millions of people to download digital content, including films, music, and TV shows. The High Court agreed with the defense that the accused cannot be extradited on the basis of alleged copyright infringement, since online communications of copyright-protected works to the public is not a criminal offense in New Zealand. However, they can be extradited on fraud charges, he said, and as that they are crimes in New Zealand. The ruling does not determine the defense guilt or innocence, merely that they can be sent to the U.S. for trial. So, basically, the copyright charges or those type of cases, Kim.com cannot be, you know, extradited for that reason. And in all likelihood, he couldn't be, once he hits the States, they couldn't then turn around and charge him for that. So those are charges that are going to be pulled off the docket, if you will. The extradition judgment in nutshell is, we won, but he lost anyways. This is a tweet from Kit.com. Dotcom's response on Twitter saying that he wanted to rule in greed. He cannot be sent to the U.S. for copyright infringement, but had lost anyways, calling the ruling a political judgment. The judges who prioritize political views and career over impartiality and the law shouldn't be judges at all, he said. Mr. Dotcom and former colleagues Mathis Ortman, Bran van der Kolk, and Finn Batu are accused of copyright infringement, conspiracy, racketeering, and money laundering. In 2005, Dotcom founded a file-sharing website, MegaUpload.com, in Hong Kong, used by millions to share movies, TV shows, and pictures and songs. Dotcom was granted residency in New Zealand in 2010, and he's been living in Auckland since then. In 2012, U.S. authorities shut down MegaUpload.com and charged Dotcom with copyright infringement, racketeering, and money laundering. The New Zealand police raided his house at the request of the FBI. The U.S. government has began extradition proceeding the same year. The extradition hearing started in September 2015 in Auckland, and on the 23rd of December, an Auckland judge ruled he could be sent to the U.S. to face charges. Dotcom, a German national living in New Zealand, has described himself as an internet freedom fighter, engaged in a David and Goliath battle against major corporations. U.S. authorities say Dotcom and others cost film studios and record companies more than $500 million or £322 million pounds in lost earnings, while making at least $175 million for themselves. A lot of this is a dispute. A lot of this will be, go through the courts, the documentation, things of that nature. I'm not sure how racketeering and money laundering comes into play here, but we will talk about that when we talk about kit.com, Mega Upload, and I guess we'll also talk a little bit about the Pirate Bay site as well. RIP, DMOZ, the Open Directory Project, is closing. As of March 14th, DMOZ will no longer be available. This is from Search Engine Land, written by Danny Sullivan. DMOZ, the Open Directory Project, has used human editors to organize websites, is closing. It marks the end of a time when humans rather than machines try to organize the web. The announcement came via notice that now showing on the homepage of the DMZ site, saying it will close as of March 14th, 2017. DMZ was born in June 1998 as Gunho, then quickly changed to Nuho, a rival to the Yahoo directory at the time. Yahoo had faced criticism as being too powerful and too difficult for sites to be listed. It was soon acquired by Netscape in November 1998 and was renamed the Netscape Open Directory. Later that month, AOL acquired Netscape, giving AOL control of the Open Directory. Also born that year was Google, which was the start of the end of human creation of websites. Google bought both the power of being able to search every page on the web with a relevancy that was a hallmark of human-powered directory. Yahoo eventually shifted to preferring machine-generated results over human power, pushing its directory further and further behind the scenes until its closure was announced in September 2014. The actual closure came in December 2014, and the old site these days is entirely unresponsive. The DMZ continued on, although for marketers and searchers, it's also long been mostly forgotten as a resource, and the only surprise today's news is that it took so long. The DMZ will live on in one unique way, the NOODP meta tag. That was a way for publishers to tell Google and other search engines not to describe their pages using open directory descriptions. While the tag will become redundant, it will also remain lurking with web pages that continue to use it for years to come. So, just another shift of the internet, of various, like, very old, well, now considered old, but if you think of the relative scheme of development, something that is not even 20 years old is closing down, if you will. And I have a link to an article from Science Daily. It's from Princeton University Engineering School. Your anonymous web browser history may not be anonymous. This is a very key study, if you will, and a very ongoing thing when it comes to, to be able to navigate the internet without people tracking you. And all the various tools that people are using and finding out either their information is getting leaked or they're still being tracked anyways. Your anonymous web browsing history may not be anonymous. This is dated January 19th, 2017, from Princeton University Engineering School. The summary. Researchers have written computer programs that found patterns among anonymous data about web traffic and use those patterns to identify individual users. The researchers note web users with active social media are vulnerable to attack. So basically just humans behaving like humans, that particular behavior is what is being tracked versus the actual tools or mechanisms that people are using, like your particular web browser, in some cases might not be leaking your data. But the nature and the way upon which you engage on the internet is what's being tracked. And that is, you know, the era is to be human, if you will. And that is probably one of the key ways in which not only are people being tracked or caught or anything of that nature, but how do you navigate the world or the internet, if you will, because the internet is very much the world, while still remaining human and doing the things you want to do. It's very hard to change one's behavior, if you will. There's some things that people can change and do change, but they change every aspect of your existence just so you won't be looked upon is very difficult. So it's a very interesting paper. I encourage you to read it on your own. This is just a little snippet, if you will, of what it's about. Raising further questions about privacy on the internet, research from Princeton and Stanford University has released a study showing that a specific person's online behavior can be identified by linking anonymous web browsing histories with so-called with social media profiles. We show that the browsing histories can be linked to social media profiles such as Twitter, Facebook, or Reddit accounts. Researchers who wrote the paper scheduled for a presentation at the 2017 Worldwide Web Conference with Conference Perth, Australia, in April. So we'll follow up on this particular paper and what it's all about. Speaking of anonymity, the overall dam workers fired for posting spillway photos to social media. California is having some significant infrastructural issues, particularly when it comes to the fact that we were in a drought, then we're not in a drought, going back and forth with that has to deal with climate change and things of that nature. But all the various dams within the state of California are frayed, if you will. And five overall dam workers were fired for posting spillway photographs to social media. A spokesperson for the California Department of Water Resources told KRN, this news television station, that a number of employees working under the Folsom Contracting Company, Skillbone Reed, violated the terms of the contract by posting the pictures. A Skillbone Reed contractor had forbidden a spillway team from capturing any activities of the dam and sharing the footage via social media. The contracting company has enforced this no social media, no photo policies at all the construction sites. Officials say the no social media, no photo policy has nothing to do with any specific topic, but the social media could become a dangerous distraction near heavy equipment. A lot of this also has to do with the fact that it was kind of embarrassing the way the spillage was handled, how the water came out, it flooded all these different areas, and this was just evidence of, you know, kind of overall state incompetence, if you will. And that is the news. So why are we talking about basic income? Well, you know, yeah, Elon Musk kind of kick-started the talk about it, or the slew of articles, if you will, the last couple of months, but technology has enabled and allowed for this kind of concept to actually be addressed and possibly implemented, whether it be the use of cryptocurrencies or a tokenized type of system with blockchain to be able to deploy the allowment of basic income to track it, if you will. The use of, as I spoke about, the chatbot that was developed by this young man to correct parking tickets, and then he went and did a chatbot for refugee statuses for England. And then I spoke about the lawyers or the software that allows for scanning and looking at all these legal documents to find the relevant information. We have developed tools that we can now deploy that allow us to give greater governance to larger and larger data sets of information and then deploy them in a pretty accurate and efficient manner, even when there are significant human errors, if you will, in the data set, we can even see that and make corrections accordingly. So with that ever-present, like be this software or cryptocurrency or this new technology being developed and implemented in different manners, you can essentially kind of re-govern, and people are looking to use software, if you will, to re-govern governments to be able to automate things to be able to eliminate the excess weight or uselessness of certain programs, or making things more efficient so that we can, in essence, deploy things better. So it's a possibility or probability within the next 5 to even 10 years for something like this to actually be implemented. And for smaller programs, which we'll talk about in Finland, to be developed and be analyzed, it is a stronger and greater probability that something like a basic income could come into fruition. And not only that, but it also speaks to the ethos of the whole concept of the individual. The individual has the greater right over anything and everything than, say, for example, a corporation or companies or even governments. The ability to help an individual actualize himself is, you know, it is cyberpunk. You know, it's the ability for an individual to be able to achieve their goals and overcome significant obstacles, to be themselves, if you will, to be or able to do anything without interference, so long as not, you know, destructive to others, speaks to kind of the cyberpunkness, if you will, and the fact that there's emergence of technology and the ability to actualize concepts and ideas that were always in the well of dreams, if you will, is important. And to be able to enable and allow people to be better in life than what they're currently at, their status is, I think, is very important. The fact that this is something that can be implemented, even at a small scale, to see if it can be implemented at a large scale, needs to be addressed. And this is kind of why we're talking about basic income. Because in actuality, there's a possibility due to, you know, even though automation can help and enable basic income to come into reality, automation is, in fact, eliminating a lot of jobs. It's making people irrelevant in a lot of different types of positions. While there will be a need for humans for a median number of things, it's going to be less and less of them. And what do you do with people who don't have an income because there's not a job to be had? Or they don't have the ability or access to train up, if you will, to achieve the jobs that do exist. And they're competing against not just a few, but hundreds to a thousand of people, not only just within their own local basis, but globally. And so these challenges need to be addressed now, while we have the means to address them before you're going to have such a discontent where you're going to have riots and revolutions and elections of very tyrannical types of people come into existence to say, we have the solution to your woes, if you will. So let's talk about Elon Musk. This article is from MSN, in particular from International Business Times by Josh Keefe. SpaceX and Tesla CEO Elon Musk was in Dubai to launch Tesla in the United Emirates at the World Government Summit Monday. The South African billionaire inventor was interviewed on stage and gave his opinion on aliens, artificial intelligence, universal basic income, and the future of humanity. Below are some highlights. Universal income will solve the economic problems caused by automation. However, the essential problems that come from a world with few workers will be harder to solve, Musk said. There will be fewer and fewer jobs that a robot cannot do better. I want to be clear. These are not things I wish will happen. These are things I think will probably happen. And if my assessment is correct and they probably will happen, then we have to think about what are we going to do about it. I think some kind of universal basic income is going to be necessary. The output of goods and services will be extremely high. With automation, will come abundance, and almost everything will get very cheap. I think what we'll end up doing is a universal basic income is going to be necessary. The much harder challenge it is how are people going to have meaning? A lot of people derive their meaning from their employment. So if there's no need for your labor, what is your meaning? Do you feel useless? That's a much harder problem to deal with. And that's also something that's kind of missing from the basic income, because even if people were able to, you know, go into the arts, if you will, and get creative, or do activities within their community, so many people, such identity is so tied into labor, and that's been such a theme for centuries upon centuries, it's going to be so hard culturally to divorce people from that. And what do you do? How do you navigate that? How do you change your culture to where your identity is not wrapped around the thing that you do? How do you find purpose in life? And that is going to be the biggest shift, the biggest problem that the problem that needs to only be addressed, but to be solved, and to be able to solve that, I think would alleviate a lot of the trepidation that people have with basic income, but with a lot of the future problems that we're going to end up dealing with. So there's a snippet of that. So kind of Elon Musk kind of kickstart the series of articles that came out about basic income the past, you know, month here. Bill Gates stepped into this conversation. Bill Gates wants a robot tax to compensate for job loss. It would help humans find new work when automation takes over. How would you deal with the likelihood that robots and automation will likely lead to many people losing their jobs? For Microsoft co-founder Bill Gates, the answer is straightforward: is tax the robots. In an interview with Quartz, Gates argues that taxing worker robots would offset job losses by funding training for positions where humans are still needed, such as child and senior care. It would even slow automation to a more manageable rate if necessary. Gates is well aware of potential pitfalls. He knows that taxation would only slow innovation by making worker robots prohibitively expensive. However, he's convinced that governments should be figuring policy out so that they're ready when there's a sudden glut of unemployed workers. He can't expect much sympathy from Europe for his ideas, though. The European Parliament has rejected a proposed robot tax and instead is interested in crafting regulation that guides the ethics behind creating and employing robots, including liability when something goes wrong. Officials don't want to leave the guidelines to third countries. According to a statement, robot makers will undoubtedly be happy. They were concerned a tax would hamper growth, but the move won't please those who want a safety net in place when the machines arrive in force. So one proposal has been that by taxing robots, you could then, in essence, help fund basic income. This discussion of taxing the thing that is driving people out of work, if you will. Robot tax and universal basic income. How do we manage our automated future? This is by Richard Hardy at New Atlas. As more and more jobs become automated, the world faces a dramatic shift in the underlying structure of labor economies over the next 20 to 50 years. The conversation is slowly becoming more prominent in mainstream, with several major figures highlighting the problem and proposing a different solution. Elon Musk maintains that the idea of a universal basic income is the best solution, while Bill Gates advocates for a robot tax. It's undeniable we're entering a revolution in our labor economy. Numerous recent reports have reached some confronting conclusion as to the effects of automation and artificial intelligence on our current workforce. A striking report from Oxford University in 2013 estimated that about 47% of the total current U.S. workforce is at risk of becoming redundant due to automation or artificial intelligence. Another study in 2015 found that 45% of jobs in the U.S. right now will be replaced by currently demonstrated technologies. Late in 2016, Obama's White House released a report warning that measures need to be taken to manage the millions of jobs that will be lost in the coming years due to technology advances. Despite societies having faced similar labor transitions in the past due to technology advancement placed in workers, we seem to be speeding through a transitional phase at a pace that may exceed our ability to naturally adapt, in an interview with Wired in 2016. President Obama expressed his concern, saying, "I do not think that we may be in a slightly different period now, simply because of the pervasive applicability of AI and other technologies." But two big solutions to our looming unemployment crisis currently hitting the mainstream conversation are the institutions of a tax on robots and universal basic income. How do we tax robots? Billionaire philanthropist Bill Gates came out in favor of robot tax in a recent interview with Quartz. Gates explained that our current climate, you have workers who earn income that is taxed, but when the job is replaced by a robot, you're losing that income tax revenue. The rest of you kind of already covered. So what's wrong with a robot tax? Well, apart from confusion, burden of implementation, for example, how much automation is a job would equal a taxable rate. This really amounts to a tax on a business that would eventually result in a trickle down to the consumer. If the business was to make the decision to automate a percentage of the workforce, the technology itself would be significant upfront costs before even adding an ongoing robot tax. Tax will ultimately either slow the rate of automation adoption and robot deployment or result in a sharp inflation of cost to general public. This, of course, is the simplistic interpretation of Vince, but not an unreasonable one. Kind of skipping around here. The big alternative being touted around the world by many is the idea of universal basic income. Money for nothing. Elon Musk has been a vocal proponent of universal basic income for several years now. Most recently in February, he reiterated his support on the idea of a summit in Dubai. UBI is even more simplistic solution to our ongoing problems than the robot tax. The idea proposes that all citizens of a country receive a regular unconditional sum of money, either monthly or annually, and that is calculated to cover basic living expenses. The UBI is thought as being an efficient way to replace the unwieldy bureaucratic mechanism of many governmental social welfare systems. Economics are still debating the cost-effectiveness of UBI, but there are many who believe the total cost of the current large and inefficient welfare system are higher than the potential cost of UBI. Charles Murray, a prominent advocate of UBI, has prolifically written in proposals to eliminate all current welfare systems in the United States and replace them with a universal U.S. $10,000 guaranteed income for every citizen. He estimates that this would be cheaper than the combined cost of the current system in place, but that has been debated with others claiming his numbers are fundamentally wrong. When his proposal was put to a panel of expert economics, 58% either disagree or strongly disagree that it is a better policy than the status quo. It is worth noting that many economic surveys in the particular poll explained that they were responding more to the generalized, extreme, and lack of nuance in Murray's specific system. Pushing aside the economic factor for a moment, the most heated debates surrounded by the implementation of UBI tend to be concerned over the social consequences. After all, if people don't need to work, then why would they? Would we basically be funding a future of lazy, unmotivated human beings? This is a common concern rallied against UBI, but it may be more of a philosophical concern than a pragmatic one. Several pilot UBI projects have shown that households receiving cash handouts actually increase their labor and production outputs. In India, several NGOs piloted UBI and found that those who received the grants doubled their production work when compared to similar households not receiving the grants. An extensive trial is Balkany in town. Okay, this is kind of covering what we already talked about. Again, this is being brought, this whole thing about people not working. I personally just don't see that. I think there's a fundamental drive with human beings to do something. And how we define what quote-unquote work is, I think we'll need to change. Is it work from labor, of creating products, if you will? Or is it work within the community? Is it work in the arts? Is it work whatever that new defining work will be? I don't think people are just going to sit around and do nothing. And I also think a lot of this is based on these very social constructs of what laziness is, what people are, who's already currently in the, you know, quote-unquote welfare system. Concepts about what poor people are and why they are poor. There's a lot of, you know, this whole pull yourself up by your bootstrap mentality to they're poor because, you know, they're lazy or they're stupid or they don't have the drive to be better, if you will. All those factors that contribute to that notion, and a lot of it has nothing to do with the reason why they are poor in itself. And you know, studies upon studies have shown that, but that concept, that social concept still is very pervasive and prevalent in people's thinking. So let's define what basic income is and kind of break down this concept, because it's something that's becoming increasingly spoken and talked about. It's not a new concept. Like many of the ideas that are being deployed now in the 21st century, some of them were part of the realm of philosophy, academic thoughts, probabilities, if you will, what-if scenarios, that if these certain factors were to occur, then these things can be deployed. Just think of when we talk about the origins of this, both the cyberpunk and cypherpunk movement, privacy was a big part of cyberpunk. The ability to communicate end-to-end encryption was a thought, if you will, an idea, an academic, something that they were trying to achieve but weren't really able to conceptualize until maybe later on in the early part of the 21st century, or in the early aughts. Privacy cash, if you will, Bitcoin, is a concept that came out of the the cypherpunk movement. And what you're having now is a lot of these ideas, a lot of these thought processes that were being developed or thought of, either be economic policy or environmental policy, things of that nature, are being actualized. Think of the urban farming techniques that people are talking about, the vertical farms where you can grow within buildings, if you will. That is something that's been bantered around for a very long time within the agricultural community. But now that technology has progressed to such a point that we can actually do that. Genetic engineering food or growing meatless animals, if you will, in the laboratory is something that was, again, thought about in academia and is now being actualized, and it's reshaping and changing the very nature of our existence slowly but surely, in some cases very rapidly, if you look at the influence that Bitcoin has had in the financial sector. But basic income, I'm going to break it down, this is coming from Wikipedia, is one of these concepts that's been around for a very long time. I would say almost 2 centuries if you think about it. And it's something that has been practiced in some sense in proto-forms, if you will, in both ancient, modern, or throughout history, I would say. But let's get into the term. So basic income is also called unconditional basic income, citizen income, basic income guaranteed, universal basic income, or universal demographic. It's a form of social security in which all citizens or residents of a country regularly receive an unconditional sum of money, either from the government or some other public institution, in addition to any income they receive from elsewhere. Here in the States, we have this program here in the state of Alaska, where the oil revenue that the state receives is split among the residents of that state. And I think you get up to almost $2,000 per year if you're a resident of Alaska. They just give that money. And there are no requirements. You just have to be a resident of the state of Alaska. So that is the only requirement for that. An unconditional income transfer or less than the poverty line is sometimes referred to as a partial basic income. But basic income systems are financed by profits of publicly owned enterprises, often called social dividend or citizens' dividends, are major components of many proposed models of market socialism. Basic income schemes have often been promoted within the contents of capitalist systems where they would be financed through various forms of taxation. Similar proposals of capital grants provided by the age of majority date in Thomas Paine's The Quarian Justice of 1795, they are paired with asset-based and glaring comparison. The phrase social dividend was commonly used as a synonym for basic income in the English-speaking world before 1986, after which the phrase basic income gained widespread currency. Prominent advocates of the concept include Philip Van Pierce, Alice McKay, Andrew Goes, Helen Stern, Peter Fountain, and Guy Standing. When Thomas Paine was talking about it, he was talking about it, you often hear about land tax, like the land usage, where if you own property, you'd be taxed an X amount. And it's to incentivize landowners to do something with their property instead of letting it sit there. This is something that's being talked about in Paris, for example. They have all these empty buildings where they're going to assess a tax to kind of force people to actually sell these properties before new ones are being built, so they don't remain empty and get dilapidated. A lot of city infrastructures have certain types of ordinance when it comes to both housing and business type structures, where there has to be a certain amount of upkeep, if you will. There's these code enforcements, but the actual forcing a property owner to actually place, you know, occupants into that property is not something that's readily done. And when Thomas Paine was talking about the concept of basic income, where the dividends of the whole, where when the landowner utilizes his property's taxes amount, that amount will get pulled and given to the rest of the people who are typically not property owners. Because if you remember at the time, property ownership was very difficult for people to obtain. And so this was a means of addressing certain inequities within the economic system. So transparency, policy aspects. Basic income is argued is much more transparent and simple welfare system than the one existing in welfare states around the world today. Instead of numerous welfare programs, there would be one universal unconditional income. So you would get rid of things like Social Security, and I'm just speaking from the U.S. perspective, Social Security, SNAP, which is the food stamp program, Medicare, Medi-Cal, all those type of Head Start even, all those type of social services that the governments, both on the federal and state level, provide would be eliminated because all you get is a lump sum of money doled out to every citizen each year for them to use for whatever purpose. There's no condition. Unlike food stamps or welfare, there's either residency conditions, there's economic conditions, there's a time gap. If you are an individual who is married, there can actually be a bit of penalties in that case. There's issues when it comes to just a single individual where you don't have, right now I believe it's like, because of the cuts that have been going on throughout states, 90 days you can, or 90 or 6 months you can have as an individual food stamps, and that's it. You can't renew, you can't garner more, even if you're still either homeless or in economic need. As is a single individual, you can't continue to use the food stamp program after 6 months. But with this, there is no type of restriction or any kind of conditions. You just have to be a citizen of that given area, in the case where I'm speaking of the United States, and you're going to be given an X amount of money, and that's it, to do what you will. You're not going to be penalized, you're not going to be taxed upon it. You can also still work, if you will, and make additional money, and that's not going to be discounted, or you're not going to have less of the basic income. You still have the X amount. And say, for example, to just keep the math simple, say every year all U.S. citizens above the age of 18 will receive $5,000 a year until upon death to do whatever they want with that money. And if they make any additional money, whether it be working in the fast food and making an additional $20,000, or an NBA player making millions, you will receive that X amount of $5,000. Poverty reduction. Basic income is often argued for because it's the potential to reduce poverty, even eradicate poverty. There's been a number of different studies that have been done in countries such as Africa. Canada did this experiment with a couple of their Native American tribes. Right now, Sweden and Finland are looking at this, and we'll talk about it, to study a program where they're giving a limited amount, but a certain amount of citizens an X amount of money, and studying and seeing what they do. Studies have been done for Africa and even in India, where they just, these charitable groups, where they just simply just give people cash. They don't give grants, or they don't give things or anything like that. Just give them, I believe it was like $50 or $150, just give them that amount of money and see what they do with it. And they found that they're able to provide sustenance in their area. They were able to get, food, clothing, and they started serving businesses. They didn't just, sit on their duff, as is often the complaint when it comes to the social welfare programs throughout the world. Basic income and growth, or BIG, allows for potential economic growth. People may decide to invest in themselves, earn higher degrees, and get interesting and well-paid jobs that in turn could trigger growth. Freedom. Supporters commonly make 3 very different arguments that basic income promotes freedom. First, that most basic income supporters tend to be politically left right-leaning supporters, at least since the 70s, have argued that policies like basic income are free welfare recipients from the paternalistic oversight of conditional welfare state policy. Second, Philip Van Paris has argued that basic income at the highest sustainable level is needed to support real freedom, or the freedom to do whatever one might want to do. By this, Vampira means that all people should be free to use the resources of the earth and the external assets people make out of them to do whatever they might want to do. Money is like an access ticket to use those resources. So to make people equally free to do whatever they want to do with the external assets of the world, the government should give each individual as many such access tickets as possible. And this is the highest substantial basic income. So basically, the concept is you establish the basic needs of people, which is shelter, clothing, food, security, and transportation. If all those means are covered by the basic income, like a $5,000 a year allotment, then that allows for a certain sense of security, a certain sense of ability to move forward. When you don't have to worry about rent, when you don't have to worry about where your next meal comes from, that stress level is alleviated. And it allows for the flexibility of people to be able to move about and do things economically they wouldn't be capable of doing because so much of their income is going towards those things. I believe a recent study last year established that 30% of Americans' income is going towards housing, towards renting. Look where that amount would go to if that was something that was already covered right off the bat. That 30% could then go into things like a small business or education or paying down debt or actual consumption of items and things to help the economic, economy grow, because we are in a capitalist system and you need people to consume. And if they're not consuming things, then there's stagnation and there's less jobs, less products, those type of deals. But if the basic necessities are covered, if that's not a concern, then the economic growth of the people can, not only on an individual basis, but as a whole, would grow a much rapid pace than it is currently right now. The third, at least, is Thomas Paine. Some supporters have argued that basic income is needed to protect the power to say no, which these supporters argue is essential to an individual status as a free person. If some other group of people controls resources necessary to an individual survival, the individual has no reasonable choice other than to do whatever the resource-controlling group demands. Before the establishment of governments and landlords, individuals had direct access to the resources needed to survive. Just going out in the forest, killing, cultivating land, things of that nature. Before the establishment of governments and landlords, individuals had direct access to... But today, resources necessary to the production of food, shelter, and clothing have been privatized in such a way that some have gotten a share and others have not. Therefore, this argument goes that the owners of those resources owe a compensation back to the non-owners, sufficient at least for them to purchase the resources or goods necessary to sustain their basic needs. This redistribution must be unconditional because people can consider themselves free only if they are not forced to spend all their time doing the bidding of others simply to provide basic necessities to themselves and their family. Under this argument, personal, political, and religious freedom are worth little without the power to say no. So if your basic necessities are met, just the very bare essentials, if you have food, if you have shelter, you have clothes on your back, you have the means to transport from point A to point B at will, you can do things like you can say no to that MIC job or no to that IT particular job. You can say no to certain concept or companies. I mean, how many people you know in life are working a job simply because they have to? That's the only means for them to make an income, but they don't like their job or the company that they work for. Now you are given the power to people say, no, I don't want to do that because my bare necessities are being met and I can do something else. And that could radically change just the concept of, corporations and companies and how they act. If a corporation, for example, you see boycotts all the time. Like, for example, it's found out that certain shrimp companies were using slave labor. So people were boycotting those brands because of their labor policy, but most people don't, particularly, like restaurants and large corporations or other corporations. That's the only means for them to get shrimp. They can't say no. They don't have the means to go out there with their own shrimp trolleys and get the shrimp without the usage of slave labor. Now with something like that, where the basic necessities are met, where maybe you could invest in your own shrimp trolley and you don't have to utilize, Bubba Shrimp to get your shrimp because they use slave labor, then maybe Bubba Shrimp is not going to use slave labor because it wants to make a profit, and it can't make a profit if people are not going to spend their dollars towards them. Work incentive. There's also a belief among creditors that people have free, unconditioned money, they will not work as much and get lazy. Less work means less tax revenue and hence less money for state and cities to fund public projects. There's also a concern that some people will spend their basic income on alcohol and drugs. If there's a disincentive to employment because of the basic income, it's however expected that the magnitude of such a disincentive would depend on how generous the basic income were to be. Some campaigners in Switzerland, which is a country that's experimenting, and I believe also Finland, suggest a level that would only just be livable, arguing that people would want to supplement it. Tim Marshall, a writer and blogger, has argued that traditional welfare schemes create a disincentive to work because such schemes typically cause people to lose benefits around the same time their income rises. They form a wealth trap where the marginal tax rate is 100%. He has asserted that this particular disincentive is not such a property shared by basic income as the rate of increase is positive to all incomes. So basically, you're not being punished if you make more money versus welfare. You lose those food stamps. You lose those the housing incentive. if you start to generate above an X amount of level. In one study, even when the benefits are not permanent, the hours worked by the recipients of the benefits are observed to decline by 5%, a decrease of 2 hours in a typical 40-hour work week. While the experiment had been conducted in the United States and Canada, the participants knew that the benefits were not permanent, and consequently, they were not likely to change their behavior as much as the same manner had the GA been ongoing. As a result, the total hours worked fell by about 5% on average. The work reduction was largest for second earners in the two-earner household, and weakest for the main owner. Further, the negative work effect was higher the more generous the benefit level. However, in studies of the Moncode experiment in the rural Dauphin Montem in the 1970s, the only two groups who significantly less were new mothers and teenagers working to support their families. New mothers spent the time with their infant child, and working teenagers put significant additional time into their schooling. Under McCone, the reduction in work effect was modest, about 1% for men, 3% for wives, and 5% for unmarried women. Another study that can contradict such decline in work incentive was a pilot project implemented in 2008 and 2009 in the Navajo village of Omarty. The assessment of the project after its conclusion found that economic activity actually increased, particularly through the launch of small businesses and reinforcement of the local market by increasing households' buying power. However, the residents of Old Barney were described as suffering dehumanizing level of poverty before the introduction of the pilot, and as such, the project's relevance to potential implications developing economics in developing economies is not known. So because they didn't have as much things, they were actually building the things that did not exist. What happens when all these things already do exist? What would be the economic output? And a lot of people that counter this argument about the decline in work advocate that what people are doing with their time instead of working is spending time with their family, raising their children, be more proactive in their social existence, their community structure, either volunteering within their own community, because now they have the freedom and the time to do so. They're able to sit down and actually help their child with their homework. They're able to take their child to after-school activities, where before their child wasn't able to do those after-school activities because they didn't have transportation. But now that mom or dad are both switching on and off, or even just a single parent, was capable of doing so because they had the means to do so. And so that changes the kind of overall, I would think, long-term social impact if when you have an active participant in it, in people's lives, and, speaking just particularly of children, then their general welfare increases. And when their general welfare increases, when they do become, 18 or a productive, become a more productive citizen, if you will, it's like a domino effect, if you will. Affordability. The affordability of basic income proposed relies on many factors, such as the cost of any public service it replaces, tax increases required, and less tangible auxiliary effects on government revenue and or spending. For example, successful basic income schemes may reduce crime, thereby reducing requiring expenditures on police and justice. One of the biggest factors or driving factors of criminality is income base. The inability to make income by legitimate means. And I'm not saying like a make job level means. I mean, actually being able to do a sustainable, proper, the 36 to 45K range it takes to actually have a decent existence in the United States. And so people turn to criminality to be able to try to achieve that. Which is something you can't do with a make job, which most of them are paying below 22K or below, even if you work full-time. You literally have to work two full-time jobs to make jobs to obtain that same level of 35 to 45K, the bare minimum of having a decent living in the United States in order to achieve that, two jobs instead of just one. The key principles, the cases of basic income affordability can be summarized this way. Welfare substitution, basic income will substitute to a wide range of existing social welfare programs. Tax rebates, state subsidies, and work activation spending, all those budgets, including administrative costs, will be reallocated to financing basic income. Auto financing or basic income, although basic income is paid to everyone universally, most people whose earnings are above the median income are in fact net contributors to the basic income scheme. Living through an income tax in practice it means that the net cost of the basic income is much lower than the raw cost calculated as a sum of monthly payments to the whole population. more fiscal redistribution. In addition to reforming and optimizing the existing tax system, additional taxation could be implemented to fully finance a basic income scheme. Some proposals frequently mention the effect they need for a tax on capital, carbon tax, financial transaction tax, etc., which do not currently exist in most jurisdictions. And money creation. In addition to tax reform, the power of the central banks to create money would be used as one funding channel for basic income. So those are different things. There's other things that people have talked about how to finance basic income, particularly if cost in other areas, if crime is going down, then you're not paying for policing and prison systems. If you're not paying food stamps and housing costs for lower income people, then that money is being allocated differently. It may, in fact, be less than what's normally was distributed before. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the pilot programs from this Wicked thing. And then I'm going to talk about why people are, and the different reasons why people are going to talk from this Wicked definition here. So the Permanent Fund of Alaska was established and perhaps to be seen as a permanent system rather than a basic income plot. The same could perhaps be said about the Bolstow family also. Being those two big systems apart, they are some of the most well-known basic income pilots of the date. The experiments with negative income tax in the United States and Canada in the 1960s and 70s, the experiment in Nairobi, the experiment in Brazil, the experiment in India, the Give Directly experiment, the study in rural North Carolina, You Should Know Those 2015 experiment, 2016, Ontario, Canada announced plans to run a basic income pilot with a discussion paper on the program expected in the fall. It's actually something that's being more talked about, and I believe that paper is coming out much sooner than the fall. And a town in Montomoba, Canada experiment with basic guaranteed income in the 1970s. So this has been kind of studied and looked about. President Nixon and the Republicans looked at this in the 70s, but it was shot down in Congress of establishing a basic income in the United States. So the basic income and ideology, so economic perspectives, is broken down into four categories. Economics and sociologists have advocated a form of basic income as a means for distributing the economic profits of publicly owned enterprises to benefit the entire population, also referred to as social dividends, where the basic income payment represents the return for each citizen on the capital owned by society. These systems would be directly financed out of returns representing the return to each citizen of the capital owned by returns on publicly owned assets, and it features the major components of many models of market socialism. Eric Olin Wright, for example, characterized basic income as a project for reforming capitalism into an economic system by empowering labor in relation to capital, granting labor greater bargaining power with employers and labor markets, which will gradually decommodify labor by decoupling work from income. This will allow for an expansion in scope of social economy, granting citizens greater means to pursue activities such as the pursuit of the arts that do not yield strong financial returns. It also, people argue, also allow for people to be a stronger part of the community. There has been a significant decline in community activity here in the United States, where the same level of volunteerism that the greater generation was known for, where they were in every kind of community activity you could think of, is not apparent among baby boomers, millennials, and some descent to Gen X and millennials. That's kind of shifted in the sense that with millennials and younger Xers, they were required through either their colleges or high schools to participate in their community. At the same time, when the economic crash occurred, a lot of millennials and Xers did begin to participate in volunteerism, to either because they were out of work or because they had a job and they saw what was going on as a means to negate some of the negative effects that were happening during the economic collapse. But it's by no means at the same level as the great generation, the World War II generation, that the level of community activity, and a lot of it has to do just with economics. People don't have the time because they don't have the means to be able to take time to do those type of activities. And with a basic level of income, you could essentially see some of that happening. You see more volunteerism. You might see more cleanup projects off the highway, or you'll see more activity and reading programs or mentoring programs, things of that nature. That is something that many people who advocate for basic income says is a plus benefit to society as a whole, because instead of paying for tutors or paying for those resources, you will have people that are from the community, working within the community, in nonprofit organizations that already exist, and deploying those people in a more effective manner, because they have the people now, and they'll be able to deploy those resources to the people in the most need. I'm going to skip the rest of this because it's more of a nuanced thing, but the Gregorist view, geolibertarians seek to synthesize preparing libertarianism and GOS, or gregarious philosophy of land as unowned commons or equally owned by all people, citing the classic economic distinction between unproven land and private property. The rental value of land is produced by labors of the community and as such rightfully belongs to the community at large, not solely to the landlord. A land value tax is levied at an annual fee for exclusive access to the section of the earth, which is collected and redistributed to the community either through public goods, such as public security, or a core system, or is in the form of basic guaranteed income called a citizen's dividend. A geolibertarians view the LVT as a single tax to replace all methods of taxation which are deemed unjust violations of the non-aggression principle. This is something that was kind of brought up when Thomas Paine talked about it. This is something that's been expounded upon and talked about, where you would have this land value tax, and a lot of people, the sort of wing of the libertarianism, go for this because of the non-aggression principle, which we'll talk in depth about because of there are manifestos, but the non-aggression principle also influenced a lot of the people have developed technology and the various tech movements that have occurred and happened. Particularly the cypherpunk movement, that you will find people that adhere to the non-aggression principle. We have the right-wing views, which support for basic income as being expressed by several people associated with right-wing political views. While adherence to such a very general favored minimization of abolition of the public provisions of welfare services, some have cited basic income as a viable strategy to reduce the amount of bureaucratic administration that is prevalent in many contemporary welfare systems. Others have contended that it also acts as a form of compensation for fiat currency inflation. Feminist views are broken down in two categories here. They view basic income can be loosely divided into two opposing views, one in which supports basic income seen as a way of guaranteeing a minimum financial independence for women and recognizing women's unpaid work in the home, and another view which opposed basic income seen as having the potential to discourage women from participating in the workforce and to reinforce traditional gender roles of women belonging to the private area and men in the public area. You know, and that is, you know, a bit of a concern where, again, there's this concept that if there is a basic income, then people don't have to work, and in a patrilineal kind of society, or if you're a part of a social grouping that believes in that, then this is something that can be used to put women back into the home where they're just the mother and basically just the mother, the wife, if you will, and not out there in the world. The technological unemployment is one of the reasons why we're discussing basic income. Concerns about automation and other causes of technological unemployment have caused many in high-tech industry to turn to basic income proposals as a necessary implication of their business models. You have figures such as Mark Anderson, Sam Altman, Peter Diamond, Elon Musk, Bill Gates have spoken about this. The White House, in a report to Congress, had put the probability of 83% that a worker making less than $20 an hour in 2010 will eventually lose your job to a machine. Even workers making as much as $40 an hour face odds of 31% of losing their job. And so this is why we're talking about it, because just a kind of a comparison of what the job market already currently looks like. Google, as of 2015, Google employs 50,000 people full-time. Versus GM, which was one of the biggest employers in the United States, in 1986, when GM was in decline, had about 850,000 full-time employees. And if you just think of them as a nexus point of all the different types of services that come off of them and the all the different companies associated with them, there are less and less people working full-time in all these companies that are being built, particularly since a lot of what is happening is technology-based, software-based. For example, just think of when you're going to a restaurant these days, you'll see a, kind of like touchpad device where you can actually order your food and not talk to a waitress at all, and then a person comes out and just gives you your food. So you're not actually interacting or engaging with a human being. That's one less person in the restaurant, if you will, or a few less people. You see this with the automation of, there's like the 3D, there's just a story that just came out about 3D printed pizza. There's also machines that are making pizza, hamburgers. There are self-serving yogurt places where you literally just have one person in the store and you make your own yogurt. What is the name? Fresh and Easy is a chain of grocery stores that are very small, and there are no bag boys or even checkout people. You scan and check out and bag your own groceries. Even big stores now, from Target to Walmart, have these self-checking kiosks where you're not actually engaging with a cashier, so you can just do all your items yourself. There's a lot of automation that are going to these lower-end jobs, but even higher-end jobs are being affected. There was two stories recently. One last year of a kid that created an AI chat-type chatbot that got people out of parking tickets. It was a software program that allowed you to input your information, and you now can get out of your parking ticket, not having to go to the court or deal with the issue of parking violations. That eliminated a lot of costs for people, either time off of going to work and going showing up to court or paying for a lawyer or those type of fees. Those type of people can easily be done away with. There was a study about an AI bot that helped a law firm go through like an endless amount of actual paperwork, like 800K of paper documents, and was able to shift through it to the relevant documents. Documents that would took months for lawyers to actually do was done within minutes. And they were able to, it was able to spit out the relevant information for the lawyers to be able to enact onto their court cases. So there's a lot of stuff happening both on the low end and high end. Just think about your taxes. People used to have to go to accountants to get their taxes, or even go physically to an HR block. Now there's software programs where you can just scan in or download your 1040 from your employer straight into the software program, and either H&R Block or whichever tax form program you're using does it automatically for you. So there's a lot of automation that's going on, and there's a lot of jobs that are being eliminated from existence, really, and they're not really being replaced or having anything auxiliary being developed in its place. There's less and less of them. If there's something that does pop up existing, there'll be less people working. And so that's becoming a bit of an issue. And this is just still from Wicca, but a bit of a criticism, and we'll talk more about criticisms. A commission of the German parliament discussed basic income in 2013 and concluded that it's unreasonable because, one, it would cause a significant decrease in the motivation to work among citizens, with unpredictable consequences for the national economy. It would require a complete restructure of the taxation, social insurance, and pension systems, which would cost a significant amount of money. The current system of social help in Germany is regarded more efficient because it's more personalized. The amount of help provided is not fixed, and it depends on the financial situation of the person. For some socially vulnerable groups, the basic income would be insufficient. It would cause a vast increase in immigration, it would cause a rise in the shadow economy, and the corresponding rise of taxes would cause more inequity. The higher taxes would translate into higher prices of everyday products, harming the finances of poor people, and no viable way to finance basic income in Germany was found. So that is just kind of the basic terms of it, and the criticisms and the different, philosophies going into the basic income. I have links in here of the different types of ideas from the growing need for universal basic income, which I will talk about. There is a 530 breakdown about the basic income. What would happen if we just gave people for you to read. But this is something that's going to be, I think, eventually a necessity, if you will, for people to have, for a need for people to do. You can also go to scottstanson.com. He also has a Twitter and a Medium blog where he's done a project through Patreon where you can finance his basic income, and he just goes around and talks and studies about basic income. I would say he's one of the more prominent advocates for basic income right now. Reddit has a basic income subreddit. So does MZ, I believe. That's just the concept of why, of what, again, what it is. I'm going to read a little bit from the 538 income. I mean, 538 income, the 538 article. Then I'm going to talk about some of the, what people, why it's being brought up in the news. Basically, it's being driven by Silicon Valley and the tech area, and bringing up the concept of basic income and why it is necessary and needed. So this article from 538.com was written by Andrew Flowers. It was published last year. Just kind of skipping around here. Just to highlight some key points from this article that I think is very relevant. So they talk about Switzerland, which did a vote about whether or not to bring basic income into their country. So Switzerland was one of the world's richest countries, and compared to the United States, it offers more generous health care and education to its citizens. But supporters of the referendum thinking that the government can provide even more security. We limit ourselves too much, Stubber says. I'm interested in conscious, expanding conscious, and basic income is a wonderful tool for that. It challenges a lot of assumptions we have. The entirety of the Swiss government opposed the referendum, citing potential effects on people's willingness to work and the huge fiscal costs as a reason to vote no. Even Stauber and his fellow supporters didn't expect it to pass, but he's excited by the enthusiasm and media attention he's seen for the idea in the past few years. Just getting on the ballot was a moment of hope for me and for a lot of the other people, he said. It was a moment of departure. Stauber is, what is his full name? Daniel Stauber. So the referendum didn't pass, but it's something that, you know, it was something that was just on a ballot. It was the first major country to ever have done so. So for it to get to that far shows that there is a significant momentum to address this pretty much an economic issue that's facing the entire world in and of itself. He's right. The basic income is spreading across the world. Finland and Netherlands are developing plans to study the idea. Canada will likely see an experiment in Ontario, if not on a national level. In France, several members of parliament have supported running an experiment, and the finance minister is opening it. And in January, Sam Altman, the president of Y Incubator, announced that San Francisco-based startup fund was organizing a basic income study in the U.S., which has already sort of begun. In the last 5 years, we've taken respectability, but in the last 2 years, it's become an avalanche, says Guy Standen, a British economist who founded the Basic Income Earth Network in 1986 to promote debate and research on the topic. Initially, a small cabal of young economics, philosophies, and activists, Bean has grown into the largest hub for basic income supporters, a global network with a national organization in 23 countries. It's also a great resource if you want to look further into the issue of basic income. Basic income, Standen says, is more than a good policy. He calls it essentially giving the more and more people in developing countries economies are living a life of chronic economic insecurity. He says insecurity filling populist politicians, boosting far-right parties across Europe, and the rise of Donald Trump, who was elected, and the U.S. economic stagnation increasing the appeal of extreme politics. Unless those insecurities are addressed, Sanders says the appeal is only to get stronger. Critics of the idea say it's too expensive, which encouraged people to stop working and possibly tank a country's economy. It's thought to be a political non-starter, too, especially in countries less wealthy and less generous welfare states than Switzerland. And because basic income proposes a radical reform to the existing welfare system, one that many progressives, at least in the United States, have been defending tooth and nail over the last 30 years, It makes anti-poverty advocates nervous. Max Zasky, a former economics at the Economic Policy Institute and a liberal think tank in the U.S., outlined a progressive case against basic income in 2013, calling it a distraction from raising the minimum wage, guaranteeing full employment, and rolling back Clinton-era reforms and supporting unions. All policies, he argued, more in keeping with our current system and political culture. So, you know, basic income, again, is challenging a lot of existing policies and infrastructures, and is not without its problems. I mean, how is it going to be financed? How is it going to be distributed? And again, this issue that people are not going to work, I think is just, I personally believe it's bullshit, but it is steeped into a lot of elitism and racial politics about the concept of certain types of people and certain human beings not considered full human beings, if you will, and that if you do this, then they're not going to do anything kind of concepts, but I digress. Both lovers and haters of basic income often miss an important point. We don't have great data on how it would work and who and what would happen if it did. Similar policies were tested in both Canada and the U.S. in the 60s and 70s, and both studies of the effects were either flawed or abandoned. To be honest, a full long-term universal basic income has never been tried, let alone rigorously evaluated, said Michael Fair, the co-founder and executive chairman of GiveDirectly, a nonprofit that has pioneered direct cash transfers to extreme poor, primary in Kenya and Uganda. Earlier this month, Fay announced GiveDirectly plans to launch a large basic income pilot in Kenya, giving at least 6,000 people a guaranteed income for 10 to 15 years. The hope is to find out what happens when everyone is randomly selected places and receives a guaranteed basic income for a long period, something that has never been done. And then they cover the kind of the, the histories and stuff like that. Here for the states, this is the last bit. In the U.S., we're left with patchwork benefits and indecipherable alphabet soup of programs. SNAP, SNAP, CHIP, Section 8, EITC, WICA, SSDI. The U.S. government spends nearly $1 trillion across dozens of separate programs at the state and federal level. At this Byzantine diagram from the House and Ways and Means Committee shows, this all requires enormous administrative oversight on the part of the government, and it requires the ability to navigate multiple agencies on the part of the recipients. The problem with the system goes beyond its complicated structure. Because eligibility for most social assistance is based on income, or as mean tested, recipients lose their benefits as they earn more income. This is often labeled the welfare trap or poverty trap. For example, a family of four can't qualify for food stamps if it earns more than $31,000. Those benefits phase out, or cliffs essentially create steep marginal tax rates on the poor. So this is a lot of this is eligibility limits of the U.S. government assistance programs, income for hypothetical single parent with one child, 2012. So there's significant issues of just the way in which social programs operate here in the United States and just around the world. This is this mean test, if you will, of the limits, if you will, and the fact that if you earn over just a dollar over, you can lose something. Even welfare advocates are critical of the incentives embedded in the system. If you're a dollar over, you can't get assistance, says Weston McKinley, founder and director of Sisters United, a nonprofit working with the individuals in poverty around the Washington, D.C. area. Sometimes it feels like a governmental control. We're on a leash and you can only go so far. Basic income promises an escape from the welfare trap. All the benefits will be the same regardless of circumstance, and by cutting a single check for the same amount of money, it would dramatically reduce administrative costs. The money we spend on welfare would be better spent more productive by the kind of ends we want. We spend it through a basic income, says Matt Sadowski, a philosophy professor at the University of San Diego and one of the most prominent libertarian advocates for basic income. Despite squeamish at the ideas of government handouts, some libertarians see basic income as a more efficient replacement for the current social programs, that one that would streamline the welfare bureaucracy and reduce costs overall. He also argues that basic income is superior on moral grounds. People can spend their money however they want. No longer would food stamp recipients, for example, be constrained to using their benefits to buy food or even certain types of food. This is something objectionable and open and about paternalism, treating adults as children who need to have their decisions made for them, says Zanowski. And then the article goes on. And there's quite a few good graphs, which 538 is known for, about government spending on social assistance per capita monthly, broken down by country, age, health, family, disability, housing, and other. So I want to talk about Finland real quick before we get into the negatives. I think Finland and most likely eventually Switzerland and Canada, these type of programs that they're doing will be the probably one of the best use cases to making a strong argument for universal income, for basic income. So Finland has started a radical experiment, is giving 2,000 citizens a guaranteed income with funds to keep flowing whether they participate work or not. The program, which kicked off this month, is one of the first efforts to test a universal basic income. Participants will receive 560 euro or 587 a month, money that is guaranteed regardless of income, wealth, or employment status. This article is written by Ivana Kostova at CNN Money. The idea, okay, we know what the idea is. The initial program will run for a period of 2 years. Participants were randomly selected but had to be receiving unemployment benefits or an income subsidy. The money that they are paid through the program will not be taxed. If the program is successful, it will be expanded to include all adult Finns. The Finnish government thinks that incentives could save money in the long run. The country's welfare system is complex and expensive to run, and simplifying and reduce costly bureaucracy. The change also encourages more jobless people to look for work because they won't have to worry about losing unemployment benefits. Some employed workers currently avoid part-time jobs because even a small income boost will result in their unemployment benefits being canceled. Incidentally, earnings do not reduce the basic income, so working and self-employment are worthwhile no matter what, said Marhakai Turun, the head of the legal unit at Kela, Finland's social insurance agency. The idea is not unique to Finland. Advocates point to Italy's city Lamar, which started a guaranteed basic income for the city's 100 poorest families in June. The scheme is extended to further 100 families starting Sunday. They are receiving 500 euro or $525 per month. Pilot programs are also being discussed in Canada, Iceland, Uganda, and Brazil. Switzerland last year considered giving every adult citizen a guaranteed income of $2,500 a month. The plan was rejected in the referendum. More than 75% of voters were against the measure. The best example of guaranteed income might actually be the U.S.-Alaska thing. Okay. The BIN group, the campaign for universal income, describes the first genuine universal basic income. So we'll see what the outcome will be on this one. So we kind of talk about the negatives within the positives. And even though Bill Gates is all about, you know, taxing robots, he's not necessarily expressing universal basic income. Actually, he believes that society is not ready for it. But those who do want universal basic income have spoken about different taxation forms, and one of them was taxing robots. But here is a National Review article about why universal basic income is a terrible idea. This is by Oren Cass. A UBI would only entrench our misconceptions about the relationship between the individual and the state. If you've not heard of any proposal for a universal basic income, you soon will. Under a UBI, the federal government would send each American, including children in some plans, a monthly check of, say, $800 or $1,000 to cover basic needs. A couple would receive $20,000 per year, regardless of the other income earned. A family with children get more. The bloated welfare state streamlined, poverty solved, and all of it supposedly paid for by eliminating the safety net programs that would no longer be necessary. Colonists are intrigued, data journalists excited, explainers calling enthusiasts, technologists certain that their breakthrough in artificial intelligence and robotics will leave everybody else unemployed. See, a UBI is critical to the utopian future. Some are even funding a pilot program. But others think the time for UBI has already arrived. Finland and Canada are experimenting with UBI, and Switzerland just held a national referendum on creating one, which was rejected by more than 3-1. And Andy Stern, the former head of SEIU, America's largest private sector labor union, has published a book arguing for UBI here. Charles Murray, a prominent scholar on the right, has also made a case for UBI. Former Labor Secretary Robert Reich, plugging Stern's efforts, says America has no choice. Actually, we do have a choice, one that goes far beyond safety net details to reach the very heart of the state society. A UPI would pose several practical challenges, which will be discussed later in this article, but even if we could work out, it would be rejected on principle. A UPI would redefine the relationship between individuals, families, and communities in the state by giving the government the role of provider. It would make work optional and render self-reliance moot. An underclass dependent on government handouts would no longer be one of society's greatest challenges, but instead would be recast as one of its proudest achievements. Universal basic income is a logical successor to the worst public policies and social movements of the past 50 years. They have taken hold not just through massive government spending, but through fundamental cultural changes that have absolved people of responsibilities for themselves and one another, supported destructive conduct while discouraging work, and thereby eroding the fundamental institutions of family and community that give shape to society. Okay, kind of skipping around here. Clearly defined responsibility from educating children to care for the elderly is fighting wars or fundamental society's character. The establishment of the terms of relationship, the scope of roles of civil society, and the expectations against which people judge one another. And fewer are as important or pervasive as the responsibility of providing for oneself, for one's family, and for future generations. Over the past centuries, America has shifted some of the responsibility from family, community, to government. The elderly and disabled now receive regular cash payments and health coverage. For a time, single mothers received cash support as well through welfare reform significantly curtailed that assistance. Most low-income households can receive a variety of in-kind benefits such as food stamps, housing vouchers, and Medicaid. The government's assumption of such obligations has helped mitigate severe hardship, but it also has changed economic incentives and cultural norms in ways that promote dependency over self-reliance and place accountability with entitlement. Debate continues over whether the shift has gone too far or not far enough, but through it all, even if diluted, a crucial principle has survived. If you are able to work, you should work. The safety net ensures that no one starves, freezes, or dies on the hospital set, but does typically offer a full substitute for employment. Even when the economic value of safety net benefits might approximate the earned income of a low-wage job, those benefits arrive with the constraints on how they can be spent, and with the weakened but still potential stigma of welfare. Yet more important than the stigma is the inverse phrase. Those who work to provide for themselves and their families know they are playing a critical and worthwhile role which imbues them the work with meaning no matter how unfulfilled the particular task may be. As the term breadwinner suggests, the abstract of the market economy does not obstruct the way essentials are earned. A UBI would undermine all this. Work, by definition, would become optional, and consumption would become an entitlement disconnected from production. Stripped of its essential role as a way to earn a living, work would instead be an activity one engaged by choice for enjoyment or to afford nicer things. For many proponents of this scheme, this is the point. Releasing people from any responsibility to support themselves or their family represents a zenith of hyper-individualistic culture. The goal is to maximize freedom and satisfaction by minimizing obligation and constraint. As the slogan of the moment proclaims, you do you. This should give pause to anyone who believes that the good life entitles more of the free society requires of members. As Yuval Levin writes in his new book, The Fractured Republic, to commit ourselves to more than our own will and whim, it requires a commitment precisely to the formative social and cultural institutions that we have seen pulled apart from the above and below in our age of fracture. Even if the UBI represents just one more slip in our cultural long downward slide, there is no argument in its favor. Only after halting the slide and regaining its footing can the culture hope to reclaim lost ground. But UBI proponents themselves recognize the racial nature of the shift, the radical nature of the shift they suggest. Writing at the leftist website Jacobean, Shannon Ickeby observes that a UBI has been embraced, and particularly by the post-productive left, which carries a strong feminist and ecological bent and rejects the traditional left's valorize of labor and the working class. Ickeby quoted other scholars describing the universal basic income as a capitalistic road to communism and a post-work political project. Kind of skipping around here. The present technological revolution shows no signs of following different courses. Hannibal, shush. The U.S. labor market has kept pace with population growth, adding 80 million net jobs since computers started coming on the scene in the 1960s, and more than 25 million since the internet became mainstream in the 1990s. Approximately 60% of the working age population remains employed, slightly above post-war average. Certainly, as has happened before, technology changes pose both great opportunity and great challenge for the labor market, but work itself remains both necessary and valuable. Undermining it might hypothetically someday end would be a senseless act of preemptive self-sabotage. What about poverty? Proponents say UBI could end it because each American receives a check lifting them above poverty line. But poverty is not only or even primarily a matter of material well-being. If it were, the $20,000 in safety net spending per person below the poverty line, the presence of air conditioning and cable television and cell phones in the majority of such households, even the obesity epidemic ravaging low-income communities would all be signs that the war on poverty is nearly won. But we care about social as well as material conditions, and we care about upward mobility, and by these measures, UBI may make things worse. The greatest crisis facing less educated and lower-income Americans is social, not economic, as Charles Murray, coming apart, documents in the harrowing detailed measures of social health that once looked roughly equal across economic classes now has gaping disparities, from family formation to employment to civic engagement to basic levels of trust. In 1960, Murray reports that more than 95% of white children were living with both biological parents when the mother turned 40, regardless of class. By 2000, the upper class figure was 90%, but the lower class figure had declined to barely 30%. A level so low, it calls into question the viability of the white working class communities as a place of socializing the next generation. Appreciating the status of work in these communities is critical to understanding their decline. Work gives not only meaning, but also structure and stability of life. It provides both socialization and source of social capital. It helps establishment for the next generation virtues such as responsibility, perseverance, and industrious. Yet, of the lower class households, Murray studied, the share with full-time worker declined from 81% in 1960 to 53% in 2010. Facing the trend, society can't afford to withdraw its remaining expectations that able-bodied people try to make ends meet and remain in respect for those who do. Yes, a UBI might flood those communities with additional resources, but a similar flood has already occurred over the past 40 years, with safety net spending increasing eightfold. The result has been even greater social erosion. So basically, the premise of here is that the UBI is not going to solve anything because people are not going to work. They're not going to have the industrious attitude to go out there and work. And that we've had similar social type programs, and this is no different than the already existing infrastructure, and that much of the technology cries that people have made about automation have been done before, and that people are not going to lose their jobs at the rate that people are, that the crier, if you will, is saying that they're going to lose their jobs. I'm kind of skipping around here. Okay, the three key variable characteristics of UBI is its size, its rate of phase out, and its source of funding. Proponents like to describe a UBI in which each person receives a benefit adequate to live on. The benefit phases out very gradually at a very high income levels, or else not at all, and the total cost is covered by replacing of existing safety net programs. But this violates what Professor Kevin Millen of the University of British Columbia has called the basic income and possibility trinity. Of those three objectives, a policymaker can only choose two. UBI advocates observe that the existing safety net in the United States or any other developing nation only on each person roughly what a livable basic income would cost. But it does this for only a small subset of the population, for whom benefits phase out quickly as their income rises. The UBI limited to the budget of their existing safety net would therefore offer either a small benefit to everyone or a large benefit that phases out quickly, but not both, and a UBI that offers a large benefit to everyone would require a massive budget increase. Any proposal claims to overcome the impossible trinity problem invariably contains a flaw. Take, for instance, a Charles Murphy proposal for $13,000 per year UBI paid to all adults over the age of 21, with a partial phase out to a minimum of $6,500, beginning when annual earnings exceed $30,000. Murray would fund the program by eliminating not only the entire safety net of anti-poverty programs, but also Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, agricultural subsidies, and corporate welfare. The first flaw is its inclusion of Medicare and Social Security. Medicare only spends more than $11,000 per recipient, and Social Security spends $16,000. So Murray's UBI covers only half of what the elderly earned entitlement is paid, and anyone left to rely on UBI would be unable to afford both Medicare, quality insurance, and other essentials. Note also that Murray has excluded children. A single mother with two children receiving a total of $13,000 per year would be only two-thirds of the way to the 2016 federal poverty guideline of $20,000. And Murray's plan has eliminated Medicaid, which explicitly requires her to spend at least $3,000 on health insurance. So her supposable income of $10,000 would reach less than half to the poverty line. Murray's plan is designed to... So basically, you know, the flaw is just the distribution of income. The same impossible training problem is that avoiding a phase-out cannot be considered among UBI advantages over existing safety net because a livable UBI does not phase out and cannot be funded from the existing safety net. A UBI can perform better than existing safety net only by costing dramatically more, but of course the safety net would also do better if given the extra money. For example, it would be circumventing the phase-out challenge by simply offering food stamps and Medicaid eligibility for all. That would cost the same as a no-phase-out UBI while avoiding the unconditional cash handouts that most badly damage your respect according to work. So again, the thought is if you just hand people money, they're not going to work or do anything in life. It's basically what it comes down to. And again, it all comes about how are we going to pay for this and still have the same quality or better quality of addressing the poverty issue and means for people. I do think that the concept of the flaw that people there's a big flaw for those who are against universal basic income is that people are not going to work. I think there's a big flaw. People do work even when they're on welfare or poor or something like that. They do find the means of working. They do get punished by it, but they try to work. They do work. And if they do work, a lot of times it is in the shadow economy. They work off the books so that they can provide the means for their kids without losing their benefits. Because they don't necessarily don't have either this job skill set, their children are too young, or for whatever reason cannot attain that primo job of getting, you know, 35K or a 45K household to have, you know, a decent existence in America.
So this is from the MISA Institute. Does not state who. Oh, Nathan Kibble. This is a more recent article or blog, if you will. The dangers of the basic income. Basically covers all the stuff that we already talk about, and then here is where he gets into the negatives. Where the UBI proponents go wrong. A universal basic income is not the godsend welfare policy that it initially seems to be. It does not create incentive to work, it won't help solve unemployment, and will not alleviate poverty. The truth is that the UBI will exaggerate all the factors in comparison to what exists in a more unhampered market. There's even reason to think that this will be worse in the long run than traditional means-tested welfare systems. First, UBI does not eliminate the incentive to work that are inherent in welfare programs and simply moves them around. The program must be financed after all, and any welfare system, including the UBI, is necessarily a wealth redistribution scheme. Wealth must be forced from those who have it to those who do not. This means that at some point on the income ladder, people must go from being net receivers of benefits to being net payers of benefits. The progressive taxation is necessary to finance UBI means that the more a person earns, the higher percentage of their wealth will be taken from them. The work incentives are therefore still very much present in the tax system. They've simply been transferred onto different higher income groups of people. Okay, so this is an argument that's been going on for a very long time about welfare and taxation. If people can earn a greater amount of money, they will. There's a lot of factors that are preventing that, and it's not the will to earn or to achieve greater wealth. It's not taxation. I think we'll talk about that at a different point in time because there's a little thread, but even within the cypherpunk that talks about this a little bit about, you know, people are lazy and they're just not going to do anything. They won't work. And that's not true. People who are on welfare do, in fact, work. The majority of them, an overwhelming majority of them will work. I believe it's a high, like, it's like in the 80% to 90% of welfare recipients actually have a job. It's very high. It's not like people think.
The thing is they just have crap jobs. They have the MIC jobs. They have minimum wage. They have jobs that pay them $7.75 an hour, having them only work 20 hours a week or 30 hours a week, or even if they work 40 hours a week, it is not enough to pay for a family of four. It's just not. And it's the only achievable job that they can achieve. When they do go out for other types of jobs, they are not getting hired because either they don't have the skill set or other factors are contributing to that. UBI diminishes the power of consumerism in the direct marketplace. The universal basic income shares another problem with the traditional welfare system. Far from promoting the unemployed from searching for work, the market rewards it actually subsidizes non-productive activities. The struggling entrepreneurs and artists mentioned earlier are struggling for a reason. For whatever reason, the market has deemed the goods that they are providing to be insufficient valuable. The work simply isn't productive according to those who potentially consume the goods or services in question. That's kind of iffy. In a functioning marketplace, producers of goods that consumers don't want would quickly have to abandon such endeavors and focus their efforts into productive areas of the economy. The universal basic income, however, allows them to continue their less valued endeavors with the money of those who have actually produced value, which gets to the ultimate problem of all government welfare programs. In the marketplace, wealth is earned by generating value. When someone buys a good, they've earned the money they are spending by having producing something else. This is not so with welfare programs like universal basic income. Money is forcibly taken from those who have produced enough to earn it and given to those who haven't. This allows for people who aren't producing wealth to continue to consume scarce goods. Eventually, all government welfare leads to the consumption of wealth, or at the very least, a reduction in the amount of wealth that would have been accumulated otherwise. When entrepreneurs have less need to respond to the needs and desires of the customers, consumers will find themselves with fewer choices and with lower quality choices. That means that overall, welfare makes everyone poorer than they would have been in the free market. Here is a counter argument, I guess, for UBI. If Finland or anyone else wishes to help alleviate poverty and employment, the best step is to take in the direction of reducing the cost of living and creating conditions favorable to plentiful employment. Charles Hugh Smith recently outlined the basics that this may seem obvious, but the conditions required for work to be abundant and the cost of living to be low are not so obvious. For work to be abundant, it must be easy to start a business. It must be easy to operate the new business. It must be easy to make a profit so that business can survive the first few years. And it must be easy to hire employees. All these factors require an environment of low cost compliance with regulation, low tax rates, low cost of transaction, reasonable transportation costs, reasonable cost of money, but not near zero, reasonable availability of capital for small enterprises, local and national governments that actively seek to smooth the path of new enterprises and existing enterprises seeking to expand, and a transparent marketplace that isn't dominated by politically dominant cartels and subservient to cartel government agencies. This matters because the number one cause of high cost of living is artificial scarcity created and maintained by monopolies, cartels, and the government that serves their interests. Artificial scarcity imposed by cartels in their servile state is a primary cause of soaring costs in a variety of sectors. In Scandinavia and most countries, it's become increasingly difficult to open and sustain a business. In Scandinavia, especially, labor unions exercise immense power over private businesses, pushing up costs and raising barriers to entrepreneurship and creating new businesses. As always been the case, it's necessary to create wealth before it's possible to redistribute. The policies that encourage movement towards less productive types of work will fail to produce the wealth that government planners would like to spread around. So, basically, when it comes down to the negatives for UBI is, one, the funding, which those who support UBI agree. Two, whether or not it's going to work, which, you know, those who support UBI agree that there is no guarantee of it actually being an effective system. That's why I guess they're encouraging smaller scale demonstration. And three, I think we caught with funding. Whether it worked, three, the cost of it, I guess you can say, the overall cost, not just funding, you can say those are separate things, and four, what it will do to society, and this is where the divergence really is big. Those who are against UBI, and already are against, you know, welfare programs to begin with, that people are not going to work, and I just don't think that is the case. That people are going to be so dependent on government. I think it will, what it will do, because there's no restrictions, will allow people to seek out work better, if they will, if their basic necessities is met. Also, there's a big, huge problem when it comes to the argument of you know, wealth generators or whatever, is that we don't value labor, especially in the United States. We don't value the production of what a person does. We just don't. And it fundamentally comes down to just the formation, or particularly in this particular capitalist society in the United States, of free labor. You know, the U.S. was built off of slavery. It had it for 400 years. It's why it was able to propel itself into the economic power horse that it is. And when slavery ended, or at least the commercial aspect of slavery ended, I highly recommend watching the 13th documentary. I believe it's on Netflix and other streaming sites. It talks about the prison system, the prison complex. Labor in general was still not valued. You see all those posts all the time, particularly in Reddit or blogs and stuff, about, you know, child labor forces, how children worked, how it was a good thing that people worked 12 to 14, 16 hour days. And it is not a good thing. It was not good to society. You hear things about, you know, well, if you were a bum or something like that, you had to, you know, do these menial labor things. I don't think what people understand or discuss when talking about poverty is how many people just simply died because they were malnourished, because they didn't have the economic means to go to a doctor and treat themselves. Suicide rates, the death rate for people, particularly below a certain economic place, was very, very, very high. And so the fact that the addressing the poor, if you will, the issues of poverty, people, you know, actually didn't starve. People actually did die. Children were abandoned. People, you know, because they got a bum leg or an affected tooth, or got hurt on the job, you know, lived really, really shitty, horrible lives, and had, you know, died very, very young relative to what we do now. And because we have the kind of practices in place in even the welfare state, that is not happening at the rate that it has happened in the past. As a result, you actually see poor people, you know, more. They weren't ushered in enclaves, if you will, or pushed to the side, or I don't know. I'm kind of going on a tangent here, but what I'm getting to the point is that this, you know, in general, don't value people's labor. If they can get away with free labor, they would have free labor. There's too much emphasis on the creator, if you will, the entrepreneur, and not enough on the entire system. Also, I think what has happened, particularly within the last 50 years, everyone thinks that whatever their great idea is, you know, they have a successful business, that they're entitled to be millionaires. They're entitled to be billionaires. And I think because of crony capitalism, a lot of the nature of the way government has structured certain marketplaces has allowed for the rise of far more millionaires and billionaires than probably the market would have played out. If you look even back to the 18th and 19th century, to people that are considered extremely wealthy, like Carnegie, the Rockefellers, or the guy, Carnegie Hall gentleman, Andrew Carnegie, they had multiple businesses. They didn't just have a single business. They weren't just, you know, the business of Google, or the business of Facebook, or the business of Microsoft. Even though all those businesses did have, in fact, developed other businesses within it, they literally were in other marketplaces. They weren't just in oil. They were in cattle. They were in factories. They were in steel. They were all over the place. They had to generate multiple businesses, multiple industries, in order to obtain the extreme wealth that they had. It wasn't just a singular industry or singular process. And I think what has happened because of crony capitalism, it has given an illusion that of entitlement, that if you have this one great idea, you're going to be that billionaire, that one, or multimillionaire, and that you're entitled to it. And that's just not necessarily the case. And I think if we were living truly in a free marketplace, you would value labor, you would pay people for what the value of what they're worth. And you have an understanding that your type of business that you may be in,
You might just be upper middle class. You might just be middle class. You're not going to be a millionaire. You're not going to be a multimillionaire. You might not be a billionaire. That thing should be very, very rare because there's so much competition. It would take multiple ideas or multiple businesses or significant generational wealth, if you will, or some phenomenally great idea, if you will, for you to achieve that type of status. And I think this is where the illusion about the whole wealth taking, if you will, comes into the factor. Again, I'm kind of going on all over here, but I just fundamentally, I think the people in general don't value labor, and they are very dismissive of it. That people are not, should not be paid what they are actually worth. That somehow that is too high of a cost, if you will. The other thing again is, the whole dismissiveness of that people are not going to work, which already occurs right now within the welfare system. I think if we were to make some reforms and not have UBI, I think the caps, if you will, that have been put in place when it comes to welfare, where if you do make just a $1 over, you lose something, I think that should change. And there's been many efforts to try to make that reform. I think that should change. But again, I do believe that automation is going to eliminate a lot of jobs. I do think that it is going to make it very difficult for people to achieve greater economic status. Because you have to understand, the reason why there is a middle class in this country is not because people have a college education. It's because of manufacturing. Because you have the ability to have a low-skill job or even a very high-skill job where you can learn on the job. You can learn, you can be trained by your employer for the tasks that you're supposed to do. And you didn't have to have a degree. You didn't have to have these extra educational tasks that this burden has been put upon mostly Xers and millennials and the upcoming generation of Y, if you want to call them that. You have to already have all these skill sets before you can even get your foot in the door, and then you also have the experience. And so it's been a very catch-22 when it comes to that. We're now in an economic place where, just like if you don't have the ability to maybe know how to read or write or even drive a vehicle, you're not going to have a job. You're not going to be able to obtain a decent living of $35,000, which is very, very, not a tremendous amount of money. $35,000, whether it be individually or combined household income, which would probably put you, if both were making $35,000, towards the $70,000. So $35,000, $70,000, to be able to make that decent amount of living, if you will, is not going to be achievable. And that is going to be a big problem. There's going to be a swath of people that are super underemployed, not employed at all. And what are they going to do? They're going to either go to the shadow economy, or they're going to go drugs or criminality or something else, and it's going to be far more destructive than actually paying people a decent amount of, you know, for their wages, if you will, or making some of these reforms to the welfare system to have some kind of safety net. So that is, you know, basic income. Again, the reason why we're talking about it is because it is something that's being discussed amongst the technology world because of automation, and also because it might in fact be something that can be actually practically implemented because of automation, if you will, the ability of all the different types of software services out there, because of the blockchain technology, you'd be able to make things more transparent and tracking that these experiments are happening around the world, that this might be an idea that might come into fruition in some form. Well, that concludes the show. I just have one little tidbit to say that the HiroJa Shibe Space Odyssey network store is open on Openbazaar. You can find it under the HiroJa Shibe Space Odyssey OD. I have a few items up there for sale. One is a Harry Potter item. I have a Transformer for sale. I have an Alex Ross signed card along with
almost a complete set of the Kingdom Come extra cards if you're into comic books, and a couple other items. You can find it again on Openbazaar. It's listed under the HiroJa Shibe Space Odyssey Network, and it's the store's name is HiroJa Shibe Space Odd. O-D. Thank you, and you have a great day. Logging off. Until next time.
Thank you for listening. Please rate and review either through iTunes or Stitchers or any of the podcasting apps that you're currently using to listen to this show. Thank you, and until next time.
This has been a HiroJa Shibe Space Odyssey Network production.